folks, can I have your attention for just a moment, please? Good evening. I think we are going to be getting started here in a few minutes, but if you have not yet found a seat, I urge you to come inside and work on that, because there's not many left. If you need assistance, please ask an usher to help you, but if everybody could come on in. Just a couple things before we get started. If you need to exit during the program tonight, we ask that you would use the doors in the back. They're less of a distraction than these on the side that open up to the outside. In the event that you have small children with you that might pose a distraction to others, we do have a room available on my left and on your right where you can still see and hear, but you cannot be seen or heard. You're welcome to use that. It works for unruly adults as well. So, if you brought a cell phone with you tonight, I would ask if you would please turn it off so that we can enjoy the time together without distractions. We will try to get started right at 7 sharp. So thank you for coming, and we'll get started here in just a minute. Okay, I think we are ready to begin. Good evening to all of you, and thank you for coming to join us for a night of celebration of our Lord. Before I get started into the serious stuff, I've got to tell you a story of something my 3-year-old son said a week or two ago. He has the gift of optimism at times, and you guys have probably heard the saying before, when life hands you lemons, make lemonade. Well, he has a new version of that one. So he was reading a story with his grandmother recently. She was looking through a kid's book with him and had all these scenes from domestic life. And in one of them was an illustration of a fire truck pulling up to a building that was on fire. And he asked, "So that's a fire truck, and that's a fire." And he looked at the flames roaring out of the window of the house, and he said, "Did somebody bring marshmallows?" Now, I don't know what that has to do with anything tonight. Unless it's to say that he has a childlike sense that even in terrible tragedies, something really good can come out of it. And I guess in a sense, that's what we're here to celebrate too. Tonight, we're here to celebrate life overcoming death, light overcoming darkness, love conquering hate. In a sense, the story of Jesus' triumph over the grave is the culmination of the overarching theme of the Bible, that of captivity and redemption, of the lost coming home where they belong. We see this theme unfold in layers throughout the scriptures, as God's people are exiled by their enemies, oppressed in bondage in foreign lands. But the story never stops there. God looks on them with compassion and raises up a mighty deliverer, a redeemer, who leads them out on a triumphant journey back to their homeland. Whether it was Moses leading the Exodus from Egypt, or Nehemiah calling a remnant out of Babylon to rebuild Jerusalem, all of these deliverers were but prototypes of what was to come. They ultimately pointed to the one and only Savior who would overcome death itself to free his people from slavery to sin and fear and bring them back home to God. The book of Hebrews says that the Old Testament heroes of faith confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return, but now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. Ever since Adam and Eve's exile from the paradise of Eden, this longing for home seems to be hardwired into the subconscious roots of humanity. Throughout history, many remarkable journeys have been motivated by this deep sense that we are strangers and pilgrims destined for a better country. My father-in-law once shared with us that our English word nostalgia, now used primarily to refer to a wistful yearning for the past, was originally coined in old war-torn Europe as a term that meant something like homecoming. It came from Norse, Gothic, and Old English roots that meant to heal, to recover, to return safely home. I was surprised to learn that by 1833, the word nostalgia actually came to be listed as an endemic disease in the British Cyclopedia of Practical Medicine. This reference work defined it as the concourse of depressing symptoms which sometimes arise in persons who are absent from their native country when they are seized with a longing desire of returning to their home. Those who suffered from it were literally homesick. By the time of the American Civil War, the disease of nostalgia was considered a serious medical problem by the North. In 1867, the U.S. Sanitary Commission recounted that in the first 2 years of the war, there were reported 2,588 cases of nostalgia and 13 deaths from this cause. Yet the report went on to say that, quote, these numbers scarcely express the real extent to which nostalgia influenced the sickness and mortality of the army. Thus, only because it interfered with the efficiency of war, nostalgia soon became a negative term used to mock those who suffered from it, hoping it would shame them into resuming killing and dying for the cause of the state. Only many years later did the word take on the more innocuous connotations of its modern usage. Nonetheless, some of history's most inspiring odysseys have sprung from just such a yearning for a homeland. Sometimes, as with Abraham, or with the first pilgrims who came to America, this homing instinct even pulls people toward a land to which they've never been before, but they're nonetheless certain that it's home. Many testimonies of personal transformation also follow this same theme of coming home. Some of you may remember the story of Barry and Patty Hirsch, a Jewish couple who first came to our congregation 50 years ago. Our church was just beginning then in a little rundown chapel called Voice in the Wilderness, situated on what contemporary news sources called the worst block in all of New York City. After years of disillusionment with various political and religious movements, Barry and Patty were on a spiritual search for answers when they happened to see a little band of people singing out across busy East 14th Street one night in Manhattan. After that, their four-year-old son, Sam, pestered his parents to go listen again to the music of the God People, as he called them. They resolved to visit the little chapel on the upper floor of a tenement building. When they walked in, Brother Blair was preaching from the book of Exodus about how when Moses was in Midian, far from his home, he had a son, and he named him Gershom, which in Hebrew means a stranger in exile. Barry remembers that Brother Blair said, "You're a stranger. You're a wanderer in the earth, and you feel like you have no home. You're far from home." Barry describes it this way: "It was so real. God's light was penetrating my heart and my life. We wound up at the end of that meeting having an experience being filled with God's Spirit. We danced out of that meeting down the stairs, three or four steps at a time. It was like we had a whole new life." Barry and Patty were home, because home is not just a geographical place. Home is finding the presence of God in His people. And according to Jesus, coming home is synonymous with the resurrection power we're here to celebrate tonight. In His famous parable of the prodigal son, the father describes his son's homecoming with these words: "This son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost, but now he's found." Barry and Patty are still with us 50 years later. Are they here tonight? Where are Barry and Patty? Somebody, okay, there they are. And today is Brother Barry's 81st birthday. Happy birthday. We salute you on your birthday, Brother Barry. What would we be without you? You have enriched our lives with so much joy and love and zeal through all these years. We love you. I won't tell you how old that little four-year-old boy is today, but he'll be conducting the orchestra here tonight. So, we see another example of the power of nostalgia in the Zionist movement that ultimately rebirthed the nation of Israel as a homeland for the Jewish people. Tonight, we'll open our second session with a Hebrew song called Habaita, which means homeward. The arrangement also incorporates a piece of the anthem of the Zionist movement, first sung in 1887, called Hatikva, the Hope. Its lyrics speak of the 2,000-year-old cry of Abraham's children to be restored to the lands of their fathers. We have many Jewish people in our community who owe their very existence to the pioneers who sacrificed to see this dream come to pass. But allow me to just focus briefly on the ancestors of one native Israeli couple that many of you know. Originally secular kibbutzniks, Tzafrir and Noah Yarden became believers and joined our community about 38 years ago. Tonight, I'd like to share one way in which their story is now coming full circle. Tzafrir's grandparents all came from Poland, where their Jewish ancestors had been living for at least 800 years. In the mid-1920s, one of his grandfathers heard the Zionist call and determined to leave for Palestine at just 19 years old. No one in his family can understand it. Tzafrir's grandmother's mother laid down across the railroad tracks, saying, "This train is going to move only over my dead body." Tzafrir's grandmother, only 20 years old, also boarded the train, but her brothers came and pulled her off the train, asking her to reconsider. She went back home, only to find the rest of her family sitting on stools observing Shiva, the traditional Jewish mourning for the dead. They were mourning for her. She stayed in the house for 3 days without eating as the town rabbis tried to talk her out of her decision. Then she walked out and got back on the train to Palestine. Those gut-wrenching decisions to follow the pull towards a homeland were to prove more crucial than anyone could have known at the time. Nearly all the rest of Safrir's family stayed in Europe and were murdered in the Holocaust. On Noah's side of the family, her grandfather once told her that when he was growing up in Russia, if a Jewish girl was acting up, her mother would threaten to give her in marriage to one of the crazy Zionists who would drag her off to Palestine. Then in 1923, Noah's grandfather joined the movement himself. Getting off the ship in Haifa at 22 years old, he kissed the ground and said, "I'm home, and I'll never leave this land." On Noah's mother's side, her family had been successfully established in Germany for centuries. Her grandfather was a pediatrician, and her grandmother worked in a laboratory. When Hitler was elected in 1933, they closed the clinic, and her grandfather made his way to Palestine to prepare a home there. With no way to start a medical practice, he became an apprentice in a clothing factory. When her grandmother arrived at the port in Jaffa a few months later, she might have had second thoughts about the move as she handed their 9-month-old baby girl down off the ship to an Arab sailor to make the precarious passage to shore in a smaller boat. Back in Germany, she used to watch Albert Einstein taking his afternoon walk in the tidy streets and parks of cosmopolitan Berlin. Now she watched Palestinian camel trains plodding through the dirt streets of their makeshift village. But she later told Noah that the hardest thing about the move was not the privations and culture shock. It was the letters they were getting from an aunt who had moved out of Germany to Holland. This aunt told them they were crazy to go all the way to Palestine. Holland, with its stable and prosperous European culture, was a much more sensible place to wait out the storm. But the letters eventually stopped coming. They soon learned that the Nazis had invaded Holland, and the aunt died in a concentration camp, along with all the rest of her family. Noah's grandmother in Israel, on the other hand, lived to be nearly 100, and the little baby she carried with her out of Germany became Noah's mother, now known to our entire community as our beloved Safta Shosh. She's here with us tonight, I assume. Well, now there she is. She's here with us tonight to listen to her grandchildren sing. For the past several months now, Safrir and Noah have been over in Israel, spending time with their relatives and assisting our sister community there in a new endeavor. That blossoming group is comprised of about 130 people, primarily German, Canadian, and Israeli families, but also including people from South America, Africa, and even a few Americans. These homeschooling believers call their community Nachalat Shalem. Nachalat translates to English as homestead or heritage, so I'll let you guess what inspired that name. It also means inheritance. Shalem means whole or complete. It shares the same root as shalom, peace. Other derivatives can mean safe, secure, and paid for, atoned for, and forgiven. So its various meanings also imply both physical and spiritual healing, to be made whole, restored, or reconciled. Nachalat Shalem hosts an annual fair in northern Israel, similar to a small version of our Thanksgiving fair here in Texas. Last year, they held their fair on October 5th and 6th. As they served pizzas, demonstrated handcrafts, and sang songs of hope for their guests in those days, little did they realize that the very next day, October 7th, would shock the world and go down in history as perhaps the worst day Israel has ever known. On that infamous morning, the world reeled from the news that hundreds of Palestinian terrorists had massacred over 1,000 Israeli civilians, taking over 200 hostages. In the ensuing days, as the rocket barrage on Israel intensified and the war escalated, around 200,000 Israelis were evacuated from their homes and relocated to kibbutzim and hotels in safer parts of the country. The consuming question in the minds of the Nachalat Shalem community as they prayed for the victims was, how can we help? Some participated in early relief efforts for the displaced people, and from this experience, an idea was born. Why not host our own mobile fair to bring some hope and healing to these hurting families wherever they have fled? Maybe this would be a way of communicating that whatever they're going through, the story isn't over. Love and life will prevail. Those of us in Texas were also eager to help raise the funds to support this effort. The passage from Isaiah 61 burned in all of our hearts. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who grieve in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Nachalat Shalem has now hosted 14 of these pro bono festivals of hope, with the most recent one being yesterday. Most of them have been in the Galilee region, right where Jesus did most of his ministry of healing. Safrir's home kibbutz, named Beit Zera, was one of the first to welcome the effort. Attendees are comprised mainly of displaced families, including survivors of the massacre, families of the hostages, and families of fallen soldiers. The results have been very rewarding. I heard that a child whose father is deployed by the IDF came to the fair and smiled for the first time since the outbreak of the war. A visiting grandmother remarked, "This day is so special for me. It's the first time since the war started that my granddaughter had the courage to be under the open sky because she's afraid of the rockets. But here she's relaxed." One afternoon, as our children's choir was singing, "Reach out and touch somebody's hand, make this world a better place if you can," another Israeli guest leaned over and said, "It's not just touch somebody's hand. You've reached out and touched our souls today and brought us such peace." A mother of triplets who had spent 12 terrifying hours in her safe room, listening as over 40 of her friends and neighbors were slaughtered by the terrorists, was in tears during the children's music. She said, "What you all are doing here is so moving. It is true healing." Another kibbutznik said, "We've never experienced something like this before. It felt as if something was coming down from heaven." We've offered these events completely free of charge. All the food, supplies, and handcrafts are paid for by donations, and all the labor is done by volunteers from Nachalat Shalem. The last I heard, there are 7 more fairs lined up in the coming weeks, with more requests coming in almost daily as the word spreads. If you'd like to know more about it and how you can participate, we've provided a link to a webpage in tonight's handout. It's on the back of your song list there, where you can go to that webpage and watch a video and learn more of the story and what's happening there. But for now, let me read just a couple of the many letters of gratitude the Israel community has received in response. These are short. On the second night of Hanukkah, the Nachalat Shalem community brought light to our darkness. They blessed us with a day of joy, offering numerous handcraft workshops, comforting food, and a children's choir whose songs uplifted our spirits. The Sha'ar Golan community, along with over 200 people from the evacuee community, joined us joyfully, endlessly expressing gratitude for this wonderful surprise. "We welcome you, kind and generous people. Your children are like angels, beautiful, hospitable, eager to help and serve. You have kindled a great light in our hearts. Happy Hanukkah." And then just one more, for this from a kibbutz organizer. "To the community of Nachalat Shalem, what a wonderful day we had. You arrived at Salina Beach by the Sea of Galilee and set up an uplifting and moving event that expanded our hearts so much that we couldn't stop smiling. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for an exciting fair full of handmade crafts that heal the soul and beautify the environment. Thank you for the light and goodness that you spread and bring with you. The moving children's choir, the delicious donuts and pizzas, the flower arrangements, the card making, the candles, the making of wooden boxes and planting strawberries in them, the making of picnic tables, the key holders, the pot holders, the soap balls, and all the abundance you spread, it will continue to be with us as a memory of a big heart, a generosity, and a wonder that can only work where the value of love is real. You shall love. May this light continue to shine. So what does all this have to do with our risen Savior? Much indeed. For when he stood up in the synagogue in Nazareth to announce the beginning of his ministry, he too quoted from Isaiah 61, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And it was Jesus who told us, "Whatever you do to the least of these, you have done it unto me." So we're here tonight to continue the mission of our Savior, declaring life and hope in the face of suffering, believing that no matter what tragedy we may face, the empty tomb stands as a witness that the story isn't over. The Deliverer will yet come out of Zion. Even death is no match for his love. And though we be strangers and pilgrims on the earth, in the end, the risen Lord will return to lead the final exodus to our homeland. Thank you for coming. Let's unite together to find our home in his presence tonight as we celebrate the life, hope, and joy of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Thank you.
To be found, you're just asleep, and it's time to leave. So come on and rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're brand new, the power of death couldn't hold you. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave? Filled your veins was more than blood, the kind of blood that washes sin away. Now the door is open wide and the stone's been rolled aside. The old is gone, the light has come. So come on and rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're brand. He's given us new resurrected hearts. Ooh, he's calling us to walk out of the dark. And he's given us new resurrected hearts. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're brand.
way back on Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. Oh, for it reaches to the highest mountain. Oh, and it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood that gives me strength.
When we, these concerts, y'all have a seat, I'm sorry. Walked off without sitting you. When we first, these concerts did not, we have about, I think around 250 people up here on the platform, and they did not start this way. They started almost 35 years ago when myself and Dan and Philip and some of these were teenagers in our parents' living rooms. And, we've obviously grown a little bit since then, and we've added all these wonderful people who have come and added their parts, and they've spent many hours and many evenings over the past few weeks practicing and rehearsing to bring this. Have you enjoyed them so far tonight? But obviously, we don't fit in our parents' living rooms anymore. But then we were just a few of us and guitars and piano, and so I thought maybe we'd do just a few hymns, all sing together, living room style here, just with guitar and piano, and all join in together. I think we can. If y'all want to turn, maybe can we get just a couple of lights on here so we can? There we go, so we can see each other. There we go. There are people out there. I think, yeah, we can get it. Let's start with Nothing But the Blood of Jesus. Does that sound good? We'll all just sing together here. Start with the guitar here. What can wash away my sin? All together.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood.
Tempo here a little bit. Bring us to F sharp, Phil. Let's go to Power in the Blood. Would you be free of your burden of sin? So let's start. We'll sing the verse all together. Would you be free? Take it there. And then let's get a little fancy here. We'd get fancy every once in a while in the living room. All right, so what we're going to do, let's do the verse all together. And then in the chorus, choir, y'all can help us out too. We're going to divide down the middle of the room, choir, half and half here. And we're going to go, over here, we're going to go, there is power. And you guys say, power. You know how I don't know if these kids have it this way, but you know how on the hymnal they'll put the power with a little apostrophe there with a missing E? Okay, so don't say power, say power. All right, so there is power, power. All right, so we're going to kind of do that echo. There is power, 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 power. Then all together, wonder-working power. Then you guys say, in the blood. And we're going to say, in the blood of the Lamb. Of the Lamb. Does that sound good? We'll do that? Okay. All together. Would you be free from your burden of sin?
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood.
Would you worry?
Would you worry? Oh, the victory win. There's wonderful power.
All right, over here. There is power.
There is power.
Okay, how many of you here have wished that you could sing with Regina? Okay, Regina, here's your chance. Okay, we're going to do verse 2 and 3 now. Let's do verse 2 and 3 back to back. Regina's going to sing the question, would you be free from your passion price? She's going to sing the question, and you're going to answer, there's power in the blood, all right? And then she'll do the lead in into the chorus, there is power, and we're going to say power, all right? We're going to do the echo back, all right? Okay, so first. Band, y'all can join us in a little bit.
From your passion.
There's power in the blood.
There's power in the blood.
Would you do service for Jesus, your King?
Power in the blood.
Well, there's power in the blood. You know there's power in the blood. And would you live daily His praises to sing? There's a miracle working power. Oh, there is power. A wonder working power. It's in the blood.
Just sing the chorus and the choir can echo you and say, there is power.
There is power. Wonder-working power in the blood.
It's right there.
Of the land.
It's right there. Power.
Wonder-working power in the precious blood.
Let's modulate. Bring it up.
There is power.
Maybe that wasn't exactly living room style, but
God sent His Son.
Sing together.
They called Him Jesus. He came to love. He led for Him. He led.
All the ladies, sing the second verse. How sweet to hold. third verse with the guys, and then one day.
And then one day, I'll cross that river. I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way,
that held regret over my head is gone. These chains are ashes now that once were rusting on. I was a runaway, now I am finally home. My mind was a ghost town, haunted by yesterday, until your hand pulled me out of the grave to the freedom found only in Jesus' name.
I am forgiven, no longer lost. Now I am living in the power of the cross.
I'll tell the world of all Jesus has done for me. Oh, I am forgiven. I'm no longer lost. And now I am living in the power. Sorrow,
Just a word about this next piece. This is a brand new piece for us. This is a composition that was written by my brother Philip here on the piano for solo violin and orchestra. It's a combination of the old spiritual "There Is a Balm in Gilead" with the Cloudburst theme from the Grand Canyon Suite, which is a classical piece written by an American composer whose name I can't remember at the moment. Anyway, that old spiritual comes from Jeremiah chapter 8, where the prophet asked, "Is there not a balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there that could heal the daughter of my people?" And to that question, this old spiritual song answers, speaking of our Lord, "There is a balm in Gilead that can heal the wounded soul."
Thank you. Redeemer lives. Oh, so let all creatures grace flowing from his side, no greater sacrifice than what he all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. And I praise God for what he's done.
Oh, sing for the freedom he has won. Even death is dead and done. His life is overcome. Oh, speak, say the name above all names, over every broken place. He is risen from the grave. What he's done, what he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. And I praise God for what he's done.
Now, on a throne of majesty, the Father's will complete, he reigns in victory. Oh, sing hallelujah to our King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. Oh, sing hallelujah to our King.
Oh,
Praise God. Amen. So we're going to take a little intermission now. We haven't always done these in these events, but we did it at Christmas, and a lot of folks said thank you very much. So we're going to do that again. Now, I'm going to make a request of you that if you need to, we're trying to keep it short. If you need to use the restroom, there are restrooms on both sides of the building here. You can use any of the doors. But if you don't need the restroom, please don't stand in the aisleways talking to people, blocking all the people who do. So stand up and stretch and do whatever you need to do, but be mindful that our aisles are a little bit narrow tonight. We squeezed a lot of chairs in here, so feel free to stand up and stretch. I'm gonna blame Sam for this one. He gave me this idea, but he said, well, during the intermission, we'll just announce to you that we're going to take out one chair. So if you're last to come in, there's no guarantee that there will still be a seat. So don't be that guy. How long do we want to take? 10 minutes? 15 minutes? 15 minutes from now. We'll see you back in here. When the piano starts to play, you need to get in your chair, okay? Piano prelude will start. That means sit down. to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the blind, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor.
Abide, abide.
Oh,
He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement that brought us peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. He will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied.
Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee, even though it be a cross that raiseth me.
Upon him. Oh,
gates and doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. I'd spent the night in sleeplessness and rose with every sound, half in hopeless sorrow and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. And just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle, and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. Well, there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. And John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. We both ran toward the garden, and then John ran on ahead. And we found the stone and the empty tomb, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they'd wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Well, something strange had happened there, just what I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation could lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him. Oh, and then I saw him die. And back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. And everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. Even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. But suddenly the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that shone from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt in my confusion disappeared in sweet release. And every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace.
that last song and the picture that it paints of Peter when he had his moment of realizing this is too good to be true, but it is true. Jesus keeps his promises, and this has turned out better than I could have ever thought. You know, he became so convinced that Jesus was the answer. He could not be talked out of it. We read in the book of Acts as the church began to grow, and they tried to tell him, you can't speak anymore in this name. And he said, we cannot help but speak in this name. We're not going to stop speaking in this name. He said, there is no other name under heaven by which men can be saved. And you feel that here tonight, the presence of God. When Jesus is here, anything is possible. We're going to speak his name tonight. Amen. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn light. Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus, over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy, and Jesus for my family. I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy.
between death and life, and there on a tree the Lamb of God was crucified.
And he went on down to hell, and he took back every key. He rose up as a lion, and he set all captives free. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and life forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. Yes, he's alive. He's alive and life forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. There ain't no
Thank you so much. We do thank you all for coming to share this wonderful time with us. Can I close with a word of prayer? Lord Jesus, we're so grateful for your presence in this place tonight. We thank you that you have risen, that all things are possible for those who believe. We thank you for the power in your name. I ask, Lord, that you would shower it on each and every one of us in every circumstance that we're in, Lord. Let us be witnesses of your grace. Let us be ambassadors of your love as we leave this place. Go with each and every one of us. Keep us safe in our travels. Bring us back again in your wonderful name, the matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. Have a wonderful holiday. He is risen indeed. Ah, yes. And there's food. See, it gets better. So next door, in the fellowship hall, there will be all kinds of snacks and food. You guys are welcome to stay around and share some time with us in fellowship. So God bless you.